it's wonderful that you've got this group in Leeds. I just want to emphasise how really, really important you are. There's a whole lot of, you know, families of people accused of the crime of 7/7 here in Leeds, and if we can build bridges to these people, there are stories that they've got. And their stories are enormously precious, right, of who those lads really were. But in false flag terror, and 7/7 is an example of false flag terror, as is 9/11, there's nothing more important than real identity. Who really were these people? Because the state, when it creates fabricated terror, it steals the identity of these people. And it gives you a fake reality of who they were. And the media are full of these images of people for you to hate and fear. But that isn't the real people, okay? So there's a real identity that gets stolen away. And so it means you've got a slight possibility and a hope for a lot of the truth movement if you can get any progress in contacting any of these people, or maybe just being here, that they'll eventually come towards you. Any bridges you can build with the Muslim community is enormously valuable. But I just want to stress how important you are being here, okay? Right. Now, let's talk about the extraordinary kind of miracle or awesome thing that's happening now at this Sheffield court, appeal tribunal. Tony Farrell and a bunch of us came to London on the 6th, September the 6th, to support him. On the 5th, Ian Crane just happened to be booked at Sheffield to be a talk. Nothing in any way planned. So he came to our meeting, just because he happened to be here by chance. And also, Rory Ridley-Duff happens to be in Sheffield. Now, he's a philosopher. He's a lecturer at a college at Sheffield. And he did the one important intellectual debate that's happened in this country about 7/7. He did a for his students, philosophy students. He compared the BBC conspiracy fire programme with Moore's ripple effect. Okay? And he compared the two, very dispassionate language, a whole lot of references. And he also looked up all the references in all the newspaper articles worldwide to the Canary Wharf story. Now, I'm assuming you're familiar with the 7/7 story, okay? So he got about 17 references for Canary Wharf all around the world, but it's very much blocked out in England. Those lads shot down at 10:30 to 11 at Canary Wharf on the morning of July the 7th, okay? And he made that a crucial part of his narrative. And his conclusion was that Moore-Dibbs ripple effect video more corresponded with reality than the BBC conspiracy fire program. Okay? So, it was wonderful to meet him yesterday.
What was the name of the chap, sorry?
Rory Ridley-Duff.
Okay.
He's a professor at Sheffield Hallam University.
Can I ask you, do you have a website where I can look at what you're saying today?
Sure, yeah. terrorontheTube.co.uk.
Okay, thanks. I'd like to be able to cross-reference what you're saying today later on tonight.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. terrorontheTube.co.uk. Right. So, Rory Ridley-Duff was there. And it was wonderful seeing him. Ian Crane is Britain's number one speaker on geopolitics. And if you want the truth about where is the world going with 9/11, 7/7, I think he's Britain's number one sort of geopolitical speaker. He can easily give you a three-hour seminar about all things happening in the world. And so he just happened to be there. And basically, to cut a long story short, he was acting on Tony Farrell's behalf this morning in the appeals tribunal, okay? And basically, I think that appeals tribunal was not really expecting that. So, hardly knew what hit it, having Ian Crane really grilling police officers. Okay, shall I step back a bit? I assume some of you are not familiar with the Tony Farrell story, okay? Around July the 7th of 2010, Tony Farrell was a South Yorkshire principal intelligence analyst of the police force, right? And each year he had the duty and responsibility to prepare a statement which is called Strategic Threat
Assessment
Matrix, right? And he's a statistician, so he had to prepare this for all different threats. And a week before, and just by chance, whatever you want to call it, he had to hand it in on July the 7th, on 2010. And a week before that, his world suddenly started imploding. I know this is hard to believe. He suddenly started reading these websites, including mine, about 9/11, that it was an inside job. And the whole culture he was in the police force, you don't consider that at all. It was totally out of bounds, right? So, 2010, he suddenly realises that. And he talks to his pastor, he's a Christian, calls his pastor at the church. The pastor says, why don't you look also at the London bombing, see what you see there? Now, that's rather odd advice for a pastor to give to a police analyst. So he did. And he had this shock of realising that both those events were state terror, fabricated state terror. And this is all happening much too quickly for him, because he only had a few days to give this strategic threat assessment in. And so he gave something to the police to indicate, look, I have a moral, absolute moral duty to tell you guys the truth and to analyse correctly the strategic threat that the police face. And I therefore, as a moral ethical imperative, and also as a believing Christian, I've got to tell you that the principal threat comes from state terror organised by the government. And this isn't just in case they do another 7/7 or something. It's that as a consequence of the state being complicit, there is a breakdown of trust and confidence between us, the public, and the state. And the police are going to be in trouble if they don't take cognizance of this. So he warned his police, South Yorkshire, that there will be a breakdown of trust and public confidence if in this present situation, given that the state was fabricating terror and more and more people come to discover this. Okay, so they sacked him, very simple. He said, look, sorry, your beliefs are incompatible. So, stop me if I'm being too long. He then discovered something in 2003, an act passed which forbade you from dismissing someone on the grounds of their belief. And it had to be a religious belief or a philosophical belief, somehow seriously held. Okay, so he went to the appeals tribunal using that 2003 thing about his belief, saying he had a Christian, he believed there was a satanic new world order. So he went through all that and they dismissed it. They wouldn't have it. They said, sorry, it was something about the belief, it doesn't have the necessary integrity or seriousness. It was a ridiculous argument. So they dismissed that claim of his. So he's now coming back again. He spent all the money, basically all his savings, been unemployed for a year. And what happened next was the next 7/7 anniversary, 2011. What happened then? Suddenly, I happened to have got a room booked for our London group on the 5th of July, the London Keep Talking group. He rings me up a week or so before that. Hello, and it ends up I book him to speak there. And also, just before that, he spoke at Rich Planet. Now, I hope you all had watched the Rich Planet program on my number, Richard Hall, and Andrew's on it a few times. It's a really fun program with sort of a bit of a paranormal edge to it. So he interviewed Tony Farrell, and that really went big time. And then the next thing he was on the Alex Jones show, it was all around the world. And I put up a thread about Tony Farrell, and I've had more comments on that than any other, far more, or less put together. People were awestruck that the man had done this for the sake of his conscience. Well, anyway, that weirdly synchronised with the next anniversary of 7/7, okay? With the 2011 anniversary. Okay, what is happening now? We're coming up to the 10th anniversary of 9/11, and this is now happening. This quite powerful hearing at Sheffield Appeals Tribunal, police officers being told by Ian Cranning that they wrongly dismissed him. And that's going to go on over the next day, maximum 3 days. Okay, that's basically it. Any questions? Anyone would like to ask about it?
Yeah, I'm just curious. Has he hooked up with any other Christian organisations? Because I know that certainly within Christian groups that there is a strong belief or emphasis that there is a satanic undercurrent to, let's say, the government or to secret societies.
Not that I know, but I'm sure you'd appreciate any comment from
because
you.
Because I think that would obviously be very useful in terms of his defence.
Well, hang on, let me just say, what I'm saying now, they're not using that argument about dismissal on the grounds of philosophical belief. That apparently is, because it wasn't accepted before, they can't come back again on it.
Right.
So the argument now is that is on a different basis, but I'm sure Tony would very much appreciate contact from you about that. Yeah.
I was just going to say that you can come back to that argument, actually. It could be brought as a judicial review through to the Royal Courts. I can speak to you about that afterwards if you want something that I'm just looking at.
I love hearing legal arguments, but I never really follow them all.
Yeah.
You know, I said in the hearing today that there's a stop warning, so it's done and dusted, you can't go back to it.
You can still go back and analyse that. Any legal determination can be analysed as a point of judicial review. It doesn't matter what
they say.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, you mean they're lying?
Of course.
What?
It's a seat. That's all they do.
Seat in the court. Surely not.
What happened today, and what I'm really looking for in the answer to this question, is there's probably some description of a panel who is sitting in judgment over what's going on.
Yeah, the three of them.
Now let's, these three individuals,
yeah.
Let's imagine none of them are truthers to begin with.
Certainly not.
Do we think any pennies have dropped today? Do we think any of these people will have the integrity to come forward?
Yeah, we're really startled by Ian Crane cross-examining their witnesses.
I would like to add, you can seriously see that they really haven't been feeling about this. You know, they're engaged. It looks and feels like it seems genuine that they are like.
Well, from the Christian perspective, it's staring Satan in the face, isn't it, right now? You know, I mean, it's actually suddenly realising that you've got evil in the midst of you.
For sure, it's not very difficult to get a petition, let's say, of 1,000 Christians just saying, yeah, we believe that there is a satanic organisation and that it's prophesied in the Bible. Wouldn't that stand up in the court of law?
I think they're using that.
Yeah, part of the thing is, because of the original tribunal, it's all internal. So even a lot of it, it's not like you're in a court of law, they're giving you that thing. So now the tribunal's at its final stages. So what you're saying today, part of the argument that Ian Crane's making, is they keep like reiterating his beliefs, his views. So he's saying, well, did you look at his beliefs? Did you look at his views? Look at 9/11/77, and they've had to admit, no, we didn't. Yeah.
And also, of course, they've got an investigative role as police officers to look into.
Yeah. Good point, because what he said was, well, he's a data analyst, his job is to analyse things, and he's analysed it and come up with, guess what, the new world order. So, you know, and they've sacked him for doing his job in effect.
Yeah, exactly.
So that's the argument we're trying to put across today, is that you've not actually investigated what he said and how he said it and all the massive evidence he's got. Yeah. You've just gone, it's incompatible, and they keep using words like beliefs and views, you know, like he's pulled this, whereas, you know,
And also, he's the principal analyst in Sheffield, and there's only one.
Mm-hmm.
And he's been doing it for 20 years, so he holds the highest position mm-hmm. as an analyst.
Yeah, yeah.
And he's been doing it for 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
And so he's come forward with this analysis mm-hmm. of this big threat, and they've completely done what to know about it.
And just sacked him.
That's what you'd expect the establishment to do.
Yeah. Yeah.
But the point is that there's a certain level in the establishment where people don't know.
Exactly,
I think we're probably still below that level.
I think we are as well. I don't think well they, in that room, I understand.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Just say that again, because there's a certain level in the establishment.
Okay, right, the establishment is a pyramid, essentially.
Yeah.
Because there's centralised power at the top and everybody's got sub-managers drop down from that. So above a certain level, there's certain people that know that 9/11 was an inside job and know that 7/7 was an inside job.
Yeah, right.
And then beneath that,
right.
You've got people that are just doing their day-to-day jobs. They go into the office, they act as they think they're supposed to, and then they go home and accept the paycheck and look after the families.
Yeah.
Now, some of them think they've got an awful lot of credibility, okay? And some of them think they've got an awful lot of power because they're very clever people.
Yeah.
And some of them are just facing this evidence for the first time, maybe today, maybe a few weeks ago. Maybe when Tony Farrell brought it to them. But the central point here being that each of those has an individual decision to make as to whether to become passively resistant, actively resistant, or fully complicit once they do that.
And so, that's what Tony said, that they're being complicit if they don't.
Also there's passive resistance. You can go.
And disbelief as well.
You can do nothing active to resist it and nothing active to promote it.
And also,
just keep your cover. That's what someone who's trying to keep their cover will do.
Also, let's bear in mind that some of us have been at Moore Dibbs' trial a few months ago, which is again another very awesome breakthrough when the jury declared him not guilty. And that was met with complete media silence, right?
Yeah.
It was only us putting it on websites that it got around. Now, if by any chance this wins this case, we shouldn't be surprised if there's complete media silence in this astounding development. And so maybe our responsibility to promote it as we see fit.
Also, it may actually go the other way. If he loses it, that's their game, isn't it? Because they put him in the paper already. He was in the Sun. Yeah. So if he loses it, they'll make sure everyone knows because it's the timing of it as well.
The most disturbing thing about the whole thing is the fact that they actually control the public consciousness by what's in the TV and what's in the paper. Mm-hmm. So it's all well and good us saying that we will, you know, we've got a duty to promote it. But there's, 200 of us handing out 200 leaflets for a day for the next 200 days. We'll still only reach one tenth of 100th of the population. So what you've got to rely on is somehow word of mouth. And even when you rely on word of mouth, there's barriers to that because of hearing.
What you rely on, I think, is the people closest to you. Uh-huh. So it starts with your family. It starts with then your friends. And then that's how it comes out. That's how it gets across. And of course, you know, the internet and the alternative media.
Yeah. Okay, well, let's move on. Any other questions, or is that...
What is Tony's plan if he wins this and he's reinstated? Does he want to go back into the police, or does he want to...
That's a great question. Does he really, in his heart of hearts, want to go back into the police force? That's what we've been sort of asking him.
Amazing.
And the police are trying to make out that he doesn't really want the job anymore. And that's quite a difficult personal question. I mean, I think it would be very good for the police force if they did take it back. But basically, that's a good question. I can't answer it.
There's interesting consequences because then you have to stand by his decision. To stand by his decision, then, oh God, you know.
Well, he was told. Yeah, I can tell you. He was told by an officer that if they had accepted his thesis and kept him employed, they would have to open a case for prosecution of Tony Blair. That's what one of them told him.
Sounds
good.
Oh, he said,
that's
right. Sounds like the
right
thing to
do. Yeah. Okay, is that...
I'd just like to know, do you think Tony Blair was aware personally I'm just saying, we know Bibi Netanyahu was informed not to go on that morning. Do we think Blair was told there's going to be an event?
Oh, totally, yeah.
And
Absolutely.
So this guy is...
He was probably in on the decision of... he got...
I mean,
he
got the Olympic Games.
He probably made that. Yeah, okay, we'll do it in return for London getting Olympic Games. You know,
something... Yeah, no, it happened on the day after the decision, so it was higher than alone.
This is a little bit new to me. Has this guy been sacked, or is he just suspended?
He was sacked.
He was sacked.
Yeah.
He's just at tribunal now, trying to get his job back.
Yeah, I understand that fact. Yeah. I wasn't sure whether he was suspended or sacked. What was the reason they gave him for sacking him?
His views weren't compatible with the Sheffield Police Force.
Yeah.
His views. Although he is a data analyst, and they weren't necessarily his views, they were the analysis that he got from analysing the data.
I must be watching the wrong television, but I don't know anything about this in today.
Best thing to do is turn the telly off.
Thank you so much. Good morning. You should feel like you're waking up. Good morning.
Oh, no, I get there every morning on telly, you know. And in the evening.
No, what I mean is good long-term morning.
Okay, well, should we... Was that all that?
This part's... I read in the newspaper the other day that Tony Farrell, he refused a mental evaluation by a doctor.
That's not true.
He was claiming £140,000.
He did have a mental evaluation, and I said, yeah, they've got you right.
No, what Tony Farrell told me is that his boss said to him, you know, will you go to occupational health, you know, and he sort of said,
well, he was possibly. He was very pissed off.
Yeah, he was. He said possibly, but you know, I don't really see why because there's nothing wrong with me.
He didn't actually
point blank to refuse. That's what he told me personally.
I've heard what this chap said from several different sources.
It came out in the tribunal today that he'd actually gone to this occupational health, got a clean bill,
right,
and that's when he went into the think before, the, like the little internal tribunal.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Right.
But initially, but he wasn't particularly, he didn't want, he didn't refuse it outright, but he didn't go along with the idea, but then he later on decided.
I think he felt insulted by it.
Yeah.
Well, but there's a distinction between a full psychological evaluation and a preliminary preliminary occupational health evaluation.
Right.
Perhaps we're getting mixed stories here because he did have the occupational health but didn't,
well,
but refused to go to the full psychological
evaluation.
Yeah.
That's just
I think that's the discredit. If it's also, so what they've done is even when he had that evaluation and they gave him a 100% clean bill of health, they kept bringing it up in his
body.
They kept bringing it up, so it's all just to discredit him. It's all smoke.
I take it it's brought a good vibe amongst the police for his friends and his family. He was surely he's propagating the truth with the 77.
What Tony told me is that he there were sort of people around him who said, "Well, I want to see your case go forward, Tony." That kind of language was used around the people around him.
Yeah. But finally,
that's the kind of person that I'm talking about.
A website has opened up, and the police superintendent's in Britain. Something, a website, a blog.
Oh, the specials.
Specials,
yeah.
So it's been discussed with a real policeman hanging around about things are really moving in a big way. Okay.
That's the kind of person that I was talking about when I was saying passively resisting before.
Yeah.
The person sits in situ and just encourages what he can encourage in a very quiet way. That person spoke to him and said, "Yeah, I want to see this go to a tribunal," and so on.
Okay, well, we better move on to Andrew's talk. Can I just give my very quick 10th anniversary message? That's all right, just a minute. Right. If you all watched from The Matrix, right? I'm sure you all watched it, and it's more relevant now than ever it was made, produced in 1998. Neo is the lead character in The Matrix, and if you go 17 minutes into the film, you'll see Neo's passport come up rather briefly while he's being checked over, and you can just read the date of which his passport expires, and that is 9/11/2001. Okay? So that's quite important, that film can look towards this crucial event. And it's a film all about the fabricated illusory reality that's made around us. So that might give you food for thought. As Morpheus says to Neo, the Matrix is all around us. Unfortunately, I can't tell you what it is. You have to see it for yourself.